The jury was first called. Neither side challenged any of the members, and the business proceeded smoothly. Charles eagerly tried to picture the mind of each of its members, 9 men and 3 women, as his or her name was called, and as he or she moved into the jury box. First came the foreman, a thick-set man with greying hair, a determined manner, and the appearance of an upper-class tradesman or small shopkeeper, a man who would know his own mind, this foreman. But it would be a terribly limited mind. Charles was sure he belonged to the hard-headed, practical type, a man without imagination, who would pride himself on accepting the obvious solution to every problem, and ruling out metaphysical or psychological considerations as tommyrot. His name was Jinx. However, he was counterbalanced by the second person to be called. This was a tall, lanky individual, with dark, dreamy eyes, pale cheeks, and long, thin fingers like claws. A man, this, who would instantly feel himself in opposition to the views of his chief, who would instinctively reject the practical view, and found his opinion on what he would call psychological considerations, but which would really be his own prejudice. He followed his leader into the box. As one by one the other 10 came forward, Charles had to admit they were as representative a crowd as he could well imagine. There was the small man with the receding chin, who would always hold the opinions of the previous speaker, and his opposite, an individual with an expression of overwhelming stupidity, whose opinions no speaker on earth could move. There were ordinary, commonplace, decent-looking men, who, while trying to be fair, would be anxious to temper justice with mercy. Of the women, 2 looked over at Charles with a kindly, sorrowful glance.